So I'm going to take a slightly different approach. Rather than going in depth into one thing, I'm going to be very, very shallow, but go across many things and just give you a flavor of some of the ideas that we are trying out on nature.com, and we'll be launching on them soon. Thank you very much. So my name is Dan Pollock. I'm running nature.com, our website. As I said, I'll whisk you through a few screenshots of ideas we're trying, very loosely grouped around three themes of searching, discovery, and sharing. But first, the inevitable marketing pitch. Just a little bit about us, in case you don't know. Nature the journal, is a general purpose, high impact factor journal, but it's part of Nature Publishing Group, and we publish around just over 75 journals now in a number of different areas, from primary research through review journals. We also do some society publishing. Nature.com is the umbrella website that covers all of our publishing properties. And about a year or so ago, the consumer science magazine, Scientific American, moved into the Nature Publishing Group. So we have quite a spread of things online. Next thing to set a little bit of context, and this is really to refer back to some of the things we heard yesterday. In the good old days of print, it all used to be very easy. You basically assemble some text, maybe a bit of line art, wrapped it up in this package called a journal, and shipped it out to your reader. Along came the internet, and everything got slightly more complicated, as we've heard. There's multimedia channels, various different sorts of content feeding things at the top. And then the journal itself in the middle is becoming unbundled. Readers will typically not want to go through your carefully crafted homepage online, but they might, for example, want to search via Google and go straight to an article. So we see some deconstruction of the journal. And then finally, there's a disintermediation between the publisher and the reader. Readers tend to go via Google, they might blog, they might access things via an RSS feeder or their e-reader or whatever. And then finally, readers want to participate in a conversation. Things are becoming increasingly two-way. So the way we view things is to say, well, it's very much a user-centric world, and we see that the user sits at the center of their own universe. They go through these various tools around them, and then through those, they access the content from multiple publishers. And I think the average reader is fairly blind to publisher silos. They just want to go onto Google, search everything, and get to their article. So with that in mind, one of the focuses we've been working on is improving search. We think that by the time people get to our website, the chances are they've got a pretty good idea of what they're looking for. So what we wanted to do, firstly, was improve the precision of our searching. And to do that, we've been building out technologies. We've got XML working behind the scenes. We're putting that in a database called MarkLogic, and then building out bibliographic searching and indexing on top of that. And then based on that technology, we can then build out additional functions and bells and whistles for the end user. And one of the foundational technologies that we're quite keen on is something called OpenSearch. It's a technical standard. I put that in quotes mainly because I don't pretend to understand all the ins and outs. But essentially, it is a way for machines to share search results and also to share search queries. For us, what it delivers is the ability to very rapidly build out search functions and deliver features to our end user. So for example, this is a rapid prototype that was put together by one of our developers in a matter of days, really. I think it took us longer to make it look nice than it actually did to build out the functionality. But what you see on the right-hand side is a set of search results. But on the left, we can build out something called faceted browsing or faceted search results. So the idea is that you have quite a lot of search results based on your query. You can zoom into them by clicking one of the items on the left-hand side, for example, to narrow the search results down just to those in a particular journal, or just to those articles that were published in a particular date range. The point is, using OpenSearch, it's quite quick to build out this sort of functionality. So we've been experimenting. We've got another demo running with a cover flow idea. The idea is people can drag on the big gray boxes. Each gray box represents a search result. They can kind of flip through search results in a kind of page turn metaphor. We've also been playing around with, I'm not sure anybody would ever use this, but again, to make the point that the open search technologies is very malleable. The idea of this is you can drag those clouds from the left of the screen to the middle, and you can build up complex queries using a graphical interface, and then return search results. And then we've also been experimenting with a card index metaphor. So using OpenSearch, we can very rapidly experiment with different ways of presenting search information. Here is actually a more real-world application of that. One of the many areas of Nature.com is Nature Events, which is a roundup of different conferences and events. And we turned on the faceted search results to that. So in this particular example, there's about 1,331 results based on this search. But the idea is that by clicking the items on the left-hand side, the user can narrow that down based, for example, by date or subject area. What we can also do with search and open search technology is to build out widgets. And these are a little pop-up things that can appear on typically on your computer desktop. This is a screenshot of an Apple widget. Apple have their own widget standard. We released this a few months ago. We didn't put any publicity around it. For us, it was an experimentation based on our open search work. But the editors on the Apple website picked this up, and I think they rated it as a number 5 top editor pick for the month it was released, which we found very flattering. And we've actually put a video up on YouTube so you can see how this thing behaves. But we didn't want to limit it just to Apple. So using the same open search technology, we were also able to build out a widget based on the Yahoo widgets standard. Yahoo have their own standard for widgets that work on both Mac and Windows machines. And then also this screenshot is indicating that we can build in reasonably sophisticated search functionality to this technology. So here you're seeing an advanced search form, which allow people to specify a title or authors or date range. The next thing, and the interesting thing you can do with search, is to turn it back on your own content. And a bit like Elsevier, we're also experimenting with a revised presentation of articles. And this is a screenshot of the result of some of our experimentation and design work that we'll be rolling out shortly. So a couple of things here. Firstly, at the moment, our current article presentation is in a 3-column format. It's fairly flat. What we'd like to do is move across to a 2-column format where you get the main text on the wide column on the left, and then on the right-hand side we can plug in various extra functions. Firstly, like Elsevier, we've looked at various interactive additions we can make to the text itself. So for example, we're taking the view, it'd be quite nice if you can collapse and expand various sections in the article so you can hop through it quite quickly. We've got a figure browser at the bottom there. We've built in the various interactive linking between references within the text that allow you to drop down to the details of the reference at the bottom and hop back again and show you the context around the reference. But also for us, the right-hand side is interesting because we've built out a modular approach, because in the same way that widgets are things that you can plug into your desktop, we'd like to be able to plug in various additional areas of function to the article. So for example, the second box down on the top right shows you how many citations or how many times the article you're looking at is being cited. Or we might be able to link through to relevant news items. In the middle on the right, we've got a list of compounds in the article. Now, the point about using a modular approach is that that functionality may not apply to every discipline. So here, in something that's got a chemical emphasis, listing and calling out compounds is actually quite important. But in other areas of science, that may not be. So we can very easily switch that function on and off. The other thing about pointing search at all this is, based on the contents of the article and running some searches, we can then provide links to other related information. And just disappearing off the screen on the bottom there, that we will offer some related content features that allow you to find similar articles to this one based on similar authorship, or keywords, or subject areas. And we're still experimenting with the exact details of that. But the concept here is a bit like the one you might see on Amazon, when you go online and you're looking at something you're interested in, and you have those links that say, people who looked at this also bought that. And we want to try and experiment with some of that function, really based on searching. hopping back to the chemical compounds bit, we're also experimenting with semantic markup using slightly different technologies to Elsevier, but the principle is nonetheless the same. So this is the idea of being able to scan through full text, highlight compounds within it, and then provide your end user with the ability to click on a compound and to get more information. And based on that, we're assembling what we're terming entity pages. In this case, we're looking at chemistry. And we're assembling these through an automated process of going out there to the web and pulling in information from various sources. What we have found here is that the purely automated approach doesn't always deliver fantastic results, and that you do need some sort of editorship involved in this. So we have what we know as a technical editor, whose job it is to look at the results of the automated text mining and automated information gathering, and we provide them with online facilities. These are only available to our editors. We don't make these screens available to the public, but the idea is we can give our editors facilities to fine-tune the technology, and so make sure we keep a good quality of results up out there. So I've talked a bit about search, a little bit about a discovery of different concepts within content. The next thing is sharing. And this is a chart that was taken from a presentation put together by Morgan Stanley. The author is Mary Meeker. And if you Google Mary Meeker or Morgan Stanley, you'll find that every year Morgan Stanley publish, they put out in the public domain for free, a very comprehensive report highlighting one or two trends online. There are a number of slides talking about mobile devices, and I thought I'd just call out one of them to illustrate a point. If you look at the very steep green line, that represents the take-up of mobile internet devices in the marketplace. And the interesting thing is to compare the green line, which is quite steep, with the red and blue lines, which are much shallower. And the red and blue lines represent the take-up of desktop internet, the original web browser. And what this chart has done is superimposed the two, and is making the point that if you compare the uptake of mobile devices with, which is a very current thing, with the historical uptake of the desktop-based internet, mobile devices are being being taken up 7 times faster than the internet originally was. And indeed, you find there's about 6 to 7 times the amount of mobile devices out there as there are desktop PCs browsing the internet. So we think that mobile computing and the ability to get at the internet on mobile devices is going to be a real growth area. And to that end, we've started experimenting this area. And in the 1st of February, we're due to release the first version of our iPhone application. We've already submitted it to the iTunes store, and Apple have approved it. So we're looking forward to seeing how that's received. At this stage, we're not entirely sure how people are going to use a mobile device to access or browse content. So we think this is very much an experiment. And to that end, we're going to offer a free trial of some of our content, starting with just the Nature Journal itself, so we can invite people to sign up, play with this stuff, and then we can monitor what they do, and we can then incorporate our findings back into our development program. But if things go well, our plans will be to roll out these features across the portfolio of our products online. We think, we don't know yet, but we think that the desktop experience and what people do on their desktop will differ from what they do on mobile devices. We think they're going to use the mobile device really to skim through candidate articles, maybe very quickly read them, and then earmark ones of interest for later reading on their desktop. So we've built out a synchronization between our mobile iPhone app and the ability to save search results and get at content online. And we've yet really to decide the best business models and access controls for all this. Again, it's very much an experiment. In order to support our iPhone application, we've had to build out some infrastructure. I won't talk you through this in great detail, but at the nub of it, bottom right, is a technical standard called EPUB. EPUB is basically a way of packaging web pages into a sort of very convenient, self-contained form. And it's the standard that a lot of mobile readers use. So things like the Sony e-reader, for example, are based on an EPUB standard. So what we've done is we've taken bottom left, our XML repository of content. We've built out some technology to extract articles from that, pull in images and so on and bundle them into this format, and then we can ship them out to devices. So we very much see this as a platform approach, which will then enable us to roll things out to different content, but also hopefully in due course different devices. A quick preview of the app on the iPhone, working from the top left, we have some sort of access control. We want people to register because we see a key value of these devices as enabling us to develop our relationships with the end user, because they're very personal devices. You'll be able to browse articles, click through to the full text. The full text is quite interesting. When we first started prototyping this, we thought, would anybody really want to read a very long article on a very small device? In actual fact, it's surprisingly readable. It's quite a good experience, so we're going to be very interested to find out how well received it is. You can also click through to figures, and you can use there's a gesture-based interface on the iPhone. I don't know if you've ever used it, but you can make a pinching motion with your fingers to zoom in and zoom out, so we've built all that in. There's search capabilities on the device. For the first version of our app, we're going to allow you to search nature.com, but we've also built in a PubMed search interface, and we'll see how that works. And then we can also handle things like references and allow people to email or bookmark links to articles. So if they then want to go back online or share those with their colleagues, that they can do that directly from their device. The final thing about the iPhone app is one of the points of it is that you can use it online, you can bookmark articles, but if you then go offline, for example, you might be sitting on a train or a plane going to work, you can still read the content that you've bookmarked and downloaded onto the device. So we want to provide an offline experience as well as an online one, although the content remains within the device. You can't actually download stuff and email it out, which we feel is reasonably important as publishers. Just developing the sharing theme a little bit more, another thing we've been experimenting with is blogs and blog aggregation. We offer a number of facilities based around blogs, but one of the points I wanted to make here was one of the challenges if you are a blogger is how you can keep... Blogging is a very rapid way of disseminating information. People are not producing grand peer-reviewed content. Blogs are typically short, they're not peer-reviewed, and the author wants to get through them very quickly. But one of the problems when you blog in science is how you reference papers and other material. And so one of the things we're experimenting with is using technology to aggregate blogs and tidy up references. So the reader of the blog, when they scan through the blog text, can then easily link through to the papers referenced, even if the blog author hasn't taken the time to wire in the hyperlink and go and find the paper. And we've done this by using various APIs out there to try and disambiguate references and automatically work out the hyperlinks in blogs. And then we've wrapped that in a blog aggregation tool. And we feel that's quite important because part of publishing is to try and make content useful, maybe other people's content as well as your own. And this is one of those experimental features we'd like to see sort of how well that goes down with our readership. And building on that theme, we also recently held something called a mashup. For the technically uninitiated, a mashup is where you get a bunch of very clever technical people, some pizza and some Coca-Cola, you put them all in a room for a day, and you let them experiment and build out applications. And we ran one of those a couple of months ago, and it was based on some new technology called Google Wave. Google Wave is the next big thing being pushed by Google. It's in essence the combination of a very rich document editor, but also the ability for people to collaborate and edit that document in real time together across the internet. And it also has a very nice feature that you can then build additional functions into that editing process. So iGore is a very experimental application that we've built out that helps people insert references into their document. So as you author the document, you can type in the word cite, follow it by a colon, and type in some keywords. The iGore function will then spot that you've typed that, go out to the internet, search for some relevant papers, and then allow you to choose particular papers based on the results that come back, and then automatically build out your references section in your document. So this is basically a very early stage of an authoring productivity tool, and it's something that we want to put out there and again see if we can experiment with it and get some feedback from the community on it. And then finally, taking the sharing theme one stage further, One of the areas of our website is Nature Network. Nature Network originally started life as a physical network. We had hubs in London and Boston originally. It was very much a way of getting scientists to get together and go down the pub, which is a very important part of the scientific process, or so I'm given to understand. But Nature Network rapidly grew out to an online presence with blogging features and discussion rooms and the ability for people to collaborate online. And what we want to do is grow that out further. The diagram on the left is really illustrating the concept that as a publisher you tend to push out your publications and your own content, but of course there's also the people element to that, and the two very much start to overlap. And especially in the middle, user-generated content, UGC, things like blogs and comments, I think are where the people, the end readership, overlap the content you push out as publishers, and that very much represents the conversation I think that people are increasingly expecting to have on the web. But we'd actually like to underpin that with a more personalized way of getting at content. And if you've ever looked at iGoogle, which is a way of personalizing your Google homepage, we want to start experimenting with bringing that same idea to scientific content. And so in the next couple of months or so, we're going to be launching the next version of Nature Network, which features what we're terming a workbench. And a workbench is really an online space where you, the user, can decide which things you want to see on your own homepage. And we're building this on a technology called Open Social, which is a way of allowing people out in the community to develop their own little widgets or areas of functionality. We're going to start fairly small with a restricted set of these functions. Again, we'll run the experiment, and if we get some good feedback, then we'll start to increasingly open that out to the community and see if we can build out some a sort of greater degree of interactive functions on our workbench. So that's me done, a very quick and whistle-stop tour through a number of things. I think, as Efka said, questions will be bunched at the end, so I'd like to hand back to Efka and thank you all for listening.